Natural history museums have displays and animations that try to make the case that the continents were once joined in a formation called Pangea and then slowly moved apart to their current locations over tens of millions of years. Well, it's actually quite obvious that the continents were in fact together at one time. Evolutionists and creationists agree on this point, but did they really spread apart over millions of years, or did it happen rapidly, even within just 1 year, during the flood of Noah's time? Stay tuned to find out. The conventional idea presented in museums is that Pangea began breaking apart about 175 million years ago, and the continents have been moving apart slowly to their current locations. Today, we can use GPS measurements to confirm the direction and speed of their movement, which is in fact just inches per year. But has it always been this way, with the continents moving apart slowly? Actually, it hasn't. And we'll explain why this is the case, both biblically and scientifically. The Bible records that Noah's flood commenced when the fountains of the great deep began breaking open. The Hebrew term used for this is bakah, which means to cleave, rend, or break and rip open, to make a breach. This couldn't describe what we see any better. One of the largest tears, the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, includes perpendicular faults along its entire length, showing the formation of new seafloor that occurred rapidly during the flood, not slowly over millions of years. The raised and sloped features on each side of the rift also testify to the hot and buoyant rock that still lies beneath it. This is certainly something that happened quickly in the past and then slowed down greatly, as GPS measurements today indicate. The Bible describes these breach fountains of the great deep resulted in flooding the whole earth, with the highest hills being covered by over 20 feet of water. Everything that moved on land outside the ark died. After pouring years of study into the mechanics of the flood, six PhD scientists published a research paper titled Catastrophic Plate Tectonics, a Global Flood Model of Earth History. The research revealed that fast-moving, subducting oceanic plates were responsible for the continents breaking apart and spreading to their current locations, in contrast to the evolutionary ideas of slow continental drift and equally slow seafloor spreading. Ongoing research in this area has shown that this model also helps to explain volcanoes, mountain ranges, the shapes and positions of continents, and the generation of global tsunamis that explain rock layers. As a professional scientist, Dr. John Baumgartner has studied the flood and its mechanisms for over 40 years. Dr. Baumgartner is known for developing Terra, a computer program that investigates the flow of rock within the Earth's mantle. In 1997, U.S. News & World Report described him as the world's preeminent expert in the design of computer models for geophysical convection. Baumgartner has applied Terra to demonstrate that the Earth's mantle is indeed vulnerable to runaway instability, and that this instability is capable of resurfacing the planet in the time span of just a few months. We'll review many of these findings next. First, scientists of both creation and evolutionary persuasions agree that new ocean crust forms at ocean rift zones where two tectonic plates are moving apart. The plates in the rift migrate apart. Magma rises to fill the gap, is cooled by ocean water, and solidifies to make a strip of new ocean crust. The two plates are like conveyor belts that move away from the rift zone along one edge and usually toward a subduction zone along the other edge. At the subduction zone, the moving plate plunges into the mantle beneath and thus disappears from the surface. The main difference between creationist and secular understanding is that, in creationist understanding, during the flood, plate speeds were about 5 miles per hour instead of just a few inches per year, as measured today. The much higher speed is why the process during the flood is referred to as catastrophic plate tectonics. Next, we'll review some of the strong evidence supporting this theory, starting first with the big picture, then investigating some of the physical evidences in more detail. One of the clearest evidences is that the continents fit together like puzzle pieces. While many school textbooks credit Alfred Wegener with the discovery that the continents drifted from an original supercontinent like Pangea to their current location, it was actually a Bible-believing scientist named Antonio Snyder Pellegrini who brought this to light much earlier and published it in his 1858 book titled The Creation and Its Mysteries Unveiled. His theory was based on the biblical flood account, the obvious shape and fitting of the continents, and the fact that plant fossils found in both Europe and the United States were identical. We can see evidence around the world that the continents fit together. Just check out this map with all the ocean water removed. The deep continental shelves become visible, and we can see how the continents fit together like puzzle pieces to shape an Earth that used to be mostly a single landmass. This is especially obvious when looking at the matching jagged edges of Lower South America and Africa. We can also see this notch of submerged land off the Grand Banks of Newfoundland and how it perfectly fits into a slot north of Spain. From a biblical standpoint, the continents fit together so well because of the catastrophic linear rifting that occurred when the fountains of the Great Deep were cleaved and pulled apart just thousands of years ago. We can see how the oceanic ridge system fits this biblical explanation well, covering more than 40,000 miles and circling the Earth 1.6 times over. The next evidence is the Ring of Fire, which is a 25,000-mile horseshoe-shaped string of oceanic trenches in the Pacific Ocean basin, where about 90% of the world's earthquakes and a large fraction of the world's volcanoes occur. It is also where most of the plate subduction is taking place today. From a biblical perspective, this long belt of volcanoes and earthquakes marks the location where vast amounts of ocean plate was rapidly subducted into the Earth's interior during the flood. Today, by comparison, the speed of subduction is extremely slow, and the resulting earthquakes and tsunamis are dramatically less frequent. During the flood, however, oceanic plates were subducting much faster, a process known as runaway subduction, caused by regions of cooler rock in the upper part sinking downward toward the bottom, and the regions of warmer rock at the bottom rising upward toward the surface. Once set into motion, this process of rapid rising and sinking can run away, causing the plates to move on the order of 5 miles per hour, much faster than today's plate speed of just inches per year. From a biblical perspective, the runaway episode is the mechanism that brought worldwide flooding and tsunamis responsible for wiping out all terrestrial life on Earth outside the Ark. Computer experiments confirm these episodes of runaway subduction are inevitable under the right conditions. A major consequence of the rapid plate motion is the generation of a huge number of giant tsunamis. In today's world, at an ocean trench where an oceanic plate is steadily slipping into the mantle, the adjacent overriding plate generally is locked against it, and it is bent downward as the other plate slides into the mantle. As this motion proceeds, the overriding plate is deformed more and more in a spring-like manner until a stress limit is exceeded. At this point, the two plates unlock, significant slip between the plates occur, and the overriding plate returns to its original shape. Such an unlocking and slip event usually produces an earthquake, and in many cases, launches a tsunami. During the flood, when plate speeds were much faster than today, this same locking and unlocking phenomenon also prevailed. The higher plate speeds and the huge amount of seafloor recycled into the mantle would have generated vast numbers of huge tsunamis with wave heights in the range of hundreds of feet. The major result of rapid plate motion is the formation of the observed layer cake pattern of fossil-bearing sediments across the continents. More tsunamis today occur by this same action, but they occur much less frequently. For example, the most powerful earthquake ever recorded in Japan, and the fourth largest in history, was a magnitude 9.1 earthquake that occurred in 2011. This earthquake was caused by an undersea megathrust about 45 miles east of the coast of Japan. At the center, there was a 160-foot slip between the overriding plate that was part of Japan and the underlying Pacific plate. The sea bottom rose about 23 feet when the fault unlocked, and the resulting earthquake triggered a devastating tsunami that was 133 feet above sea level and traveled inland for 6 miles. The tsunamis occurring during the flood, however, were different, much different. With the ocean ridge bursting open rapidly and pushing the ocean floor under land continents on a worldwide scale, tsunamis were happening in cycles, several every hour, and with the long stretches of subduction zones active at the same time. The incoming phase of a tsunami has a much higher speed and is highly turbulent, which keeps the sediment in suspension but leaves behind layers of sediment as it slows down. In the retreating phase, this cycle repeats several times every hour during the 150-day inundation stage of the flood. First entombing the shallow marine life, followed by land creatures in different habitats and elevations, leaving behind what we see today in the fossil record. These types of tsunamis have even occurred in recent history, such as the tsunami caused by slipping ocean plates that hit the coast of Washington in 1700 and left behind multiple layers representing each wave of the tsunami. The next evidence that supports CPT is that the plates, which rapidly subducted under the continents during the flood, are still visible. Seismic images of the mantle reveal a ring of unexpectedly cold rock at the bottom of the mantle, beneath the subduction zones that surround the Pacific Ocean. Seismic tomography shows the cold plates in blue that subducted under the continents during the flood. We can also see the Farallon plate that subducted under North America, and the process of its subduction was the very formation of the Rocky Mountains. Evolutionists explain how oceanic plates, like the Farallon plate, slowly subducted over tens of millions of years under the North American continent uneventfully, while the millions of dinosaurs now buried in this kill zone somehow just kept living and thriving. Both secular and creation scientists agree that the Farallon plate subducted under North America, even carrying massive volcanic plateaus like the Conjugate-Shatsky Rise along with it, going from the west to the east. But we disagree, and with good reason, that the dinosaurs somehow just kept peacefully thriving in this area while this was happening. This subducting action would be like a spatula sliding beneath an undercooked pancake, creating massive folding and buckling, just like we see all over North America today. The process even explains the rapid and catastrophic formation of the Rocky Mountains. This happened just thousands of years ago during Noah's flood, when the fountains of the Great Deep were broken apart and the year-long process of the worldwide flood unfolded. Next, we have the extensive worldwide fossil record. The oceanic plates that subducted rapidly under landmasses generated cycles of tsunamis that brought staggering quantities of sediment onto land that wiped out every living creature in their paths, burying them in the muddy layers we still see today. Giant, high-frequency tsunamis that were occurring during the flood explain why today we see dinosaur graveyards around the world, including 13 states in the middle of America containing dead dinosaurs mixed with marine life. What type of flood could do this? Just how much water would it take to bury millions of land creatures under hundreds of feet of mud and sand in the Morrison Formation, a 13-state, 700,000-square-mile area? Just how did so many land creatures get buried together with marine life, with 97% of the dinosaurs found disarticulated, and many of the remaining 3% that are found intact discovered in mud and sand layers with their necks arched back, suffocating as they died? Next, we have evidence from secular geologists that the Cretaceous fossils are higher in elevation than rising sea levels alone could produce. There had to be some serious catastrophic buckling of the layers laid down by the CPT process while the layers were still wet and foldable. North America provides some clues to the massive nature of the flood. In fact, even secular geologists refer to what's known as the widespread late Cretaceous transgression, which is just technical jargon for worldwide flood. Studies have revealed that a sea level rise of 310 meters is required to flood the Cretaceous layers based on their current elevation. However, the maximum thickness of the fossil layers produced by a 310 meter sea level rise is only about 700 meters. The challenge is that, in North America, nearly 50% of the Cretaceous layers contain strata thicker than 700 meters, indicating that the continents had to sink and buckle during this global inundation. This is exactly what the catastrophic nature of the flood would have done. There's just no way that rising sea levels alone can explain the fossil record in North America. Something much more catastrophic that warped and submerged the continents just had to be involved. Next, we have one of the strongest evidences for the fast, catastrophic separation of the continents: fossil correlation. Secular textbooks and museums admit that fossils of the same species are found on matching sides of continents that were once together, but are now separated by over 3,000 miles of ocean. Did this happen slowly over millions of years as museums state, or quickly over a year during Noah's flood? To find out, let's zoom in on two areas where matching fossils exist, straddling thousands of miles of ocean in between. Look at northeastern Brazil and where it was once situated in this notch on Africa's west coast. Do you know that multitudes of the same species lived in the area where these two areas were once joined? In each of these areas, there are dozens of fossil beds where the same species of marine and land creatures are buried together in the very mud layers that killed them, including bivalves, ammonites, and multiple types of dinosaurs.
If these continents really split apart over tens of millions of years, then why are the same exact creatures and plants found on matching sides of the continents? Indeed, the same creatures in the same habitat were once thriving here. Then the flood broke, and catastrophic rifting pushed these land masses thousands of miles apart from each other. It's so obvious. Here all these animals lie, locked in their muddy graves in the same exact area they were living before the flood broke, but now they are buried in the very mud that killed them.
Heading south, we see the same situation, but this location is even more interesting. The lower regions of South America and the northern tip of Antarctica have dinosaur fossils on them, including hadrosaurs, ankylosaurus, theropods, and others that supposedly emerged and died off during the late Cretaceous period. However, evolutionary geologists hold that these two areas were never even connected during the entire time these dinosaur species supposedly showed up and then died off during the evolutionary timeline. This means we should not expect to find matching fossils in South America and Antarctica, yet we do. Therefore, the animals that were fossilized there had to be living in this area when the continents were joined. They were killed and buried when this region was catastrophically torn apart. Many trilobite species also straddle both sides of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge and testify to the rapid nature of this catastrophe, with millions of the same kinds of animals that were once living together now found buried in mud and lime layers on either side. The evolutionary view holds that these continents moved apart slowly over millions of years. If this was true, the large rivers on the continents that straddle each sides of these rifts would have left a connected trail of mud stretching from one side of the Atlantic to the other. But what we see from the evidence is that they were rapidly split apart, and then the draining and erosion started. Major rivers like the Congo, Mississippi, and Amazon run off the continents and have mud fans with only thousands of years worth of mud deposits, not millions. Also, there are flat sand bottoms on each side of these continents, showing they were split apart rapidly. They don't have millions of years worth of runoff with extensive mud extending out into the ocean. These rivers began shaping and eroding only thousands of years ago. Not millions. We also have the massive coal and oil deposits all around the world, indicating that the entire world was reshaped from the original Pangea formation with vast amounts of sediment covering and compressing the pre-flood landscape that was full of vegetation and life. Just the sheer amount of coal attests that the actions involved with catastrophic plate tectonics explain how countless megatons of pre-flood landscapes were buried during the same process that reconfigured the continents. Let's not forget about entire regions of ash deposits that are buried along with the dinosaurs. The volcanoes responsible for this ash were created by the rapidly subducting plates, again explained by catastrophic plate tectonics. The data supporting catastrophic plate tectonics being responsible for the breakup of Pangea is overwhelming. We have torn apart continents that once fit together, a 40,000-mile rift system, a massive Mid-Atlantic ridge, subducted ocean plates around the world, a ring of fire from where the plates are still subducting, a massive fossil record with the same types of creatures now separated by thousands of miles of ocean, river fans that were laid down after the continents separated, volumes of coal and oil from the rapidly buried pre-flood landscape, and ash generated by volcanoes erupting from the motion set in place by the rapidly subducting plates. Evolutionists and creationists have the same data, but this data is interpreted through worldview lenses that lead to very different conclusions. Evolution's Pangea split apart millions of years ago by random processes and led to the configuration of Earth today. If the Bible is correct, Pangea was a pre-flood paradise that became marred with sin, and the resulting judgment from God left behind a trail of incredibly obvious markers that Earth was catastrophically reshaped during the biblical flood. Looking for answers about what the Bible teaches about creation, the fossil record, dinosaurs? Download the Genesis Apologetics app from the iTunes or Google Play stores for answers to these questions and more.